much, and good morning, everybody. We're change of theme now, talking about employment and innovation and growth. Innovation, as we know, and the adoption of new technologies are essential in order to maintain a country's competitiveness in an open world economy. And as we just heard from Olivier, in fact, when there is loss of competitiveness and then we have the fixed exchange rates, free trade, free capital mobility, the equilibrium is unsustainable without huge reductions in wages and all the problems associated with those reductions. And that's why it's essential that in the countries of the Eurozone, which do have those characteristics of fixed exchange rates and free capital mobility, that it's essential that we innovate enough and we adopt enough innovation so as to converge to common levels of high competitiveness. Otherwise, there is no future to the Union. It's absolutely essential. Now, the important questions that will occupy me in this presentation are what market conditions are conducive to more innovation and growth, and how does more innovation influence the dynamics of employment? I will argue the obvious that innovation and growth can benefit all sections of society, but policy is often needed to give extra incentives and help reintegrate any losers in the new economy. My focus will be the structural changes that are caused by innovation and growth and the implications that they have for employment. Now, innovation can raise the productivity of all factors of production, so both the owners of capital and the workers can have more income. But how this income is allocated between them depends on their relative bargaining strengths and on market forces. One of the policy concerns in the last 2 to 3 decades is that capital owners have been able to secure more of the gains from growth than they were in the long period of industrialization that preceded them. And this has raised income inequality across different labor market groups with potentially difficult policy challenges. In general, wealth creation comes from growth, and although in the long run, innovation is the only driver of growth, there can be lengthy episodes of growth, some of which can stretch to 2 to 3 decades without innovation. This mainly comes from above normal capital accumulation, but also from other sources. The equilibrium implications of each growth episode depend on the reasons for growth. Growth can come from a reorganization of production, a shaking out of inefficiently employed labor, and an improvement in the organization of companies and markets. The impact of this development is very similar to that of innovation in the sense that it increases the productivity of labor, which is what we want to achieve, even if it's at the cost of some jobs. It's an innovation in a general purpose technology, office and production line reorganization, as opposed to the more easily understood innovation activity that impacts mainly on production directly. Now, temporary growth episodes can also come from imitation and capital accumulation that rises above the trends of the past. Growth in Europe after the destructive activities of the Second World War, in Japan a little later, and in the Asian tigers, which include China here in the 1980s and 90s, was mostly of this kind. This kind of growth can be very fast, creating large amounts of wealth, but it cannot last beyond 20 to 30 years because of diminishing returns to capital. Eventually, capital will need to find new and more productive ways of producing in order to maintain its high rates of return. Now, the only sustainable form of growth over long periods of time is new innovation. New innovation requires research and the incentive to apply the new ideas in the marketplace. The factors that are needed to make it happen are the three that you see in the slide that I've just put up. They are a well-trained labor force to generate and apply the discoveries, sufficient investment to enable the replacement of old and unproductive capital equipment, and a market environment that is flexible enough to accommodate the required changes in production before competitors get in first and take the benefits. Europe as a whole is not doing well along these dimensions, although there are obviously some exceptions, and I'm going to take them one at a time. It has a well-trained labor force, but when judged by the growth of modern technology companies, it does not perform very well. The modern technology giants are mostly American or Asian, in particular Korean and Japanese. The way that higher education and research are organized is important in this respect, talking about the highly trained labor force. The best way to achieve results is to combine university research with industrial R&D, as is most successfully done in the United States in places like Silicon Valley, which benefits from its proximity to the high-level universities of Stanford and Berkeley. It's not easy to achieve high standards in research in most countries, to some extent due to educational policies that do not give top-level researchers the incentive to work in those countries. At the level of top research, workers are very mobile, and they need strong incentives to stay in countries that offer less good facilities through their universities than the very top ones. The incentives needed by top researchers are not just the high salary, although that would be nice, that rewards their input into research. In order to achieve high standards in university research, universities need to be well-funded and be independent. In most countries and most universities, funding is primarily provided by government, so it may be difficult for politicians to accept that they should have limited say over salary levels, appointments, promotions, and other types of spending when they provide the money from tax revenues. But it's necessary if research is to be free of political interference. This is why there are large advantages to obtaining funding directly from private industry or distributing state funding through independent bodies like the National Science Foundation in the United States and the European Research Council in Europe, which unfortunately is having its budget cut next year. Interference with the university administrative structures and their internal procedures is less likely when the funding bodies are independent of national politics. In the United States, university budgets are over 3% of GDP, but in Europe they are less than half, about 1.3%. Americans also give more independence to their universities and public donations are more generous. According to influential observers, this is an important reason why Europe lags behind the United States in top university performance and top innovations. This is reflected in expenditure on R&D, which is also lagging behind the United States and Japan. And you can see this here. Europe is still ahead of China, but this is not likely to last for long, as Chinese R&D spending has been on an upward trend, and it closed a large gap vis-a-vis Europe in the last 10 years. But there are obviously exceptions. For example, I listed Germany along with the other averages, and you can see that the success of German industry in producing top-level export manufacturers is reflected in its R&D spending, which is even better than that of the United States, more like Japan's. Moving now to my second requirement. Successful innovation and growth also require investment because most innovations need new capital. The disembodiment assumptions of traditional economic theory, which is the solo growth model, are convenient simplifications, not depictions of reality. In particular, new investment by private companies is needed to embody the new technology, and new investment by the public sector is needed to build the infrastructure that is a necessary support for private companies. Now, in total volumes, capital formation in Europe is on par with that in the United States at about 18 to 20% of GDP. It's well below the Asian countries like China, but that's not surprising, and you see this here, private fixed capital formation. But the dynamics of investment in the recent crisis do not bode well for the structural recovery of the heavily indebted countries. In figure two that you see here, I show private investment in the United States, European Union, and the four program countries. And whereas investment fell everywhere between the peak year of 2007 and 2012, the end of recession year for most countries, 2012, in the heavily indebted countries, private investment fell by a lot more than in the other countries, but it's in those countries that we need most of the investment currently. Now, public investment is even more worrying because public investment which is more important for the infrastructure that supports industrial growth, it tells a similar, if more horrifying story than private investment, and you can see that in figure three. In proportional terms, public investment fell more than private at the time when budgets had to be cut to check the explosion of debt. Public investment is the easiest to cut or postpone, as governments say, amongst government spending programs, and this shows up especially in the indebted countries of the Eurozone. Whereas in the United States, public investment fell by a mere 6%, in the European Union as a whole, it fell by 11%, and in the four indebted countries, it fell between 40 and 60%. You might recall Larry Summers complaining yesterday about the very extremely low level of public investment in the United States. I wonder if he was aware of these figures for European Union as a whole, which is well below that of the United States, something below 2.5, whereas in the United States it's still 3.5 of GDP, but then the program countries, which are all below 2%. And about the program countries, and this level of public investment obviously cannot be good for their recovery and even for their debt reduction programs. At the time when GDP levels fell due to recession, a robust way of cutting the debt is to focus the government spending programs on items that yield a high return in the future, and government fixed capital formation is foremost amongst these. In the final analysis, I think the fault for this fall in infrastructure spending lies with the rescue programs, which did not discriminate between different kinds of government spending. Although I should say that when I pointed this out in a conversation strictly under Chatham House rules to someone who belonged to a troika of one of these countries, he said to me that even if they tried, governments wouldn't have allowed them to tell them what they should cut. They said, just give us the overall budget and we'll work on it. And you can see why they're doing it, because politically it's a lot easier to cut investment than social transfers, for example, which I think is a mistake anyway, from the innovation point of view. Now, innovation and productivity growth, however, also need a well-functioning labor market, my third pillar in this. Labor markets need to be flexible because innovation carries risks. Startups and older firms introducing new products need to know that they can recruit the workers quickly and terminate contracts when things don't work out. Inflexible labor markets make firms too cautious and introduce too many administrative burdens that work as disincentives to innovation. A flexible labor market will not by itself lead to more innovations, but it will remove impediments that could slow down the innovation potential of the country. It helps in the speed implementation of innovations and the faster adaptation to new technological conditions. And the ability to do this makes countries more competitive in world markets, and so it gives them additional incentives to invest in new cost-cutting techniques. The same applies for product market regulation, and I applaud what Cathy of the OECD just said about product market regulation, including the enterprise environment. High startup costs, either as direct payments or administrative procedures, act as disincentives to the formation of companies and to the dissolution of unsuccessful companies. High administrative operating costs have similar effects and discourage the development of an underground economy. Sorry, they encourage the development of an underground economy, high administrative costs, which is a strong disincentive to new innovation. When a job is not secure because it is not registered and regulated, neither the employee nor the employer has an incentive to engage in research or training that improves the productivity of the workforce. On this, in other words, I'm completely in agreement with what President Draghi was saying yesterday, that I should add only one qualifier. I do think, and which also relates to the discussion that Tito Boeri had with his discussion earlier this morning, I do think that structural reforms in the labor market are more effective when there is more investment taking place, because we do need the investment to support new companies, especially if we are grandfathering the old structural reforms. But investment will not by itself be, it will not by itself come on if we don't first reform the enterprise environment and the product markets. They won't, it won't by itself come in response to labor market reforms. So I strongly support in this case the prioritizing the reforms that product market reforms should come first, encourage the business, open up the business environment, make it easier to set up businesses. You know, the listing fact that Mario Draghi showed yesterday where Greece was the bottom and Italy next to the bottom. Open up those markets, those will encourage investment, and once you have the investment, it will be a lot easier to implement the labor market reforms. In other words, sequencing, I think, is quite important rather than throw everything at governments when investment is so low. Now, the reward structure moving on with my presentation, the reward structure within the company and the labor market as a whole should be such that it rewards the successful innovators more generously than the rest, even if the input is similar. And the incentives to innovate is bigger when success brings big payoffs. But here one needs to be concerned about inequality, as larger inequality due to large rewards to successful innovators will create tensions and potential conflict. The balancing of financial incentives of top innovators with sufficient payoffs for lower level employees is a very fine act and may vary from country to country and even from company to company. And it's a challenge for every policymaker in the developed world. And I don't really know the answer, to tell you the truth, about this one. Finally, a labor market needs to be competitive to attract new innovation. Even in situations where a large player dominates the market, there should be no barriers to entry that can give protection to the incumbent. In market environments where there is either actual or potential competition from new entrants, the incentive to innovate is greater because the incumbent needs to innovate to keep ahead of the competition. When monopolies are protected, as in so many state-controlled enterprises, the incentive to innovate disappears and the company stagnates. And since there was a lot of mention of Greece earlier on, I do think that this last point is the one that is holding innovation back in Greece. It's the most heavily protected and most heavily concentrated economy in the Eurozone. Almost all major sectors of the economy are dominated by one or two companies which are protected by others. And of course, that does not give any incentive for innovation. Now, let me now move on to innovation and job creation and job destruction, which is really the theme here on the employment, the structural perspectives on employment. Now, innovation brings wealth creation and more prosperity, but how does it influence employment? The best way to share the rewards from new growth is through employment, not transfers. Namely, it is to ensure that growth is inclusive in the labor market. The important question to ask then is about the ways in which innovation and growth influence new job creation and whether any displaced employees are absorbed quickly back into employment. Now, many commonly heard answers about the relation between innovation and jobs suffer, I believe, from what one might call an aggregation fallacy. There is no doubt that a company that is a successful innovator creates more jobs. But usually, this is at the cost of jobs at its competitors. Even if the company is a perceived monopoly, this is still the case. For example, Google displaced a lot of jobs in non-digital advertising and selling, even though a newspaper may not be regarded as its direct competitor. Amazon displaced many jobs in high street bookstores. But if we aggregate over all companies in a sector, we find that innovation usually destroys jobs in the sector as a whole. The jobs created by the innovator are not enough to replace all the jobs destroyed in the competitive firms that fail to innovate. It's very likely that fewer person hours are today employed to sell a euro's worth of books than before Amazon was created. But at the level of the economy as a whole, innovation creates jobs through the wealth creation and higher income of those working for the successful innovators. The jobs are created elsewhere, usually in labor-intensive services. To put it in terms of supply and demand, when a sector innovates, it increases its own supply. Demand for the sector's output does not usually increase by a similar amount, and so the increase in the sector's supply spills over to other sectors, creating demand elsewhere in the economy. Employment shifts from the innovating sector to the less innovating labor-intensive sectors. Such shifts spread the benefits from sector-specific innovations more widely and make growth more inclusive. They underlie the structural perspective of employment that is the topic of this session. Now, historically, innovation has been uneven across sectors of the economy. And before looking more closely into the implications of this for employment, I discuss more generally the type of jobs that are created in the economy as a whole when there is new innovation in some sectors. Usually the jobs that are created to absorb the workers who are displaced by innovation are in service sectors where the possibilities for labor-saving technology are limited. Such jobs are in both business and personal services. As businesses become larger and more complicated with new and more specialized technology, they hire more specialist service providers. These could be hired by the firm to provide the services internally, in which case they are classified as workers in the sector of the firm, or the firm buys the required services from specialist providers, that is outsourcing, in which case the workers providing them are classified as business service employees. Distinguishing between the two in official statistics is very difficult, although it's generally agreed that there has been net growth in business services everywhere in the industrialized world, the claim has been made that much of the growth in business services that we see in official statistics is due to outsourcing. Job creation in the personal services sector is much more straightforward to understand. As wealth grows, households travel more, consume more, and require better service that saves them time, a resource that becomes more valuable with rising living standards. This is reflected in the growth of jobs in retailing, catering, healthcare, childcare, education, and domestic service. Despite many technological improvements that benefit these types of jobs, especially retailing, in the final analysis, there are jobs that provide services directly to the public, relying on person-to-person contact. For example, in retailing, technological improvements in stocking and reordering may accelerate the time needed to deliver products. But when visiting a store, the consumer evaluates the quality of service from the personal contact that she has with the retail assistants. Similarly, domestic service has been revolutionized with the invention of consumer durables and gadgets. But although one might safely argue that the number of domestic employees is not as big as it was at the beginning of the 20th century, the numbers of employees in domestic jobs recorded in official statistics is growing as incomes grow. Jobs in both business and personal services could be well-paid jobs, but there is no guarantee that they will be, especially the ones in the personal sector. In contrast, the profits that go to the innovators that displace the workers in the first place are usually very high. Otherwise, the incentive for innovation would not be present. This may sound like reverse causation, and indeed there is an element of it. Countries that do not offer rewards to innovators may end up with less inequality between the innovators and the service providers, but they will also be characterized by less innovation. Countries that permit the growth of large inequalities attract more innovation activity, and the final outcome is the one that I have described. High profits go to the innovators, and whether wages in the jobs created elsewhere are also high depends on other factors. We see in this the risk of increasing inequality in innovating countries, and balancing the two, as I pointed out before, is one of the biggest challenges that societies face today. I now look at the dynamics of employment, and I'm going to overshoot by 5 minutes because you took about half an hour of my time, by the way. I look at the dynamics of employment now during periods of employment and structural change, beginning with a long-term look at the United States, a brief one, but long-term. I choose the United States for this purpose because it's the leading nation in innovation in its implementation. It also has reliable data going back to more than 100 years. Similar stories can be told about other industrialized countries, and I will refer to some important cases. In 1900, in the United States, when industrialization was well underway, the shares of employees in agriculture, industry, and services was about the same. It was about a third each. Was attracted, had about 35% in industry, 35% in agriculture, and 13% in services. Agriculture was mainly based on family concerns and was inefficient. Services were also inefficient. Large numbers of new immigrants were working in domestic service, looking after the children and homes of rich industrialists. John Leeds, writing in 1917, in one of the very first house-to-house surveys of working conditions in Philadelphia, found that middle-class homes employed a large number of people in early 20th century, working as cleaners, washers, clothes makers, and maintenance workers. Then the big innovation started reaching the general public. Cars, refrigerators, washing machines, vacuum cleaners, and the many other household appliances that today we take for granted. There's never been a more intense period of innovation, and there will probably never be one, as Bob Gordon many times pointed out, and I do have to say I agree with him. I don't see him here today, but even in his absence, he's been praised. Oh, he is, yeah. Oh, he is, I'm sorry. Oh, it's too far to see. Sorry. Now, people became wealthier, and demand for all kinds of goods and services grew rapidly. But the share of employment, and this is what I want to emphasize here, the share of employment in industry, where all this growth started, increased by just a little, from 35% to 40%. Of overall employment. It remained at 40% until 1970, when the big innovations came to an end and growth slowed down. It subsequently declined to 20% in the face of competition from Europe and Asia, which copied US technology. The domestic service that John Leeds found in 1900 had virtually disappeared, the workers being displaced by machines. Agricultural employment also virtually disappeared, falling from 35% of total employment at the beginning of the 20th century to 3% at the end. The main beneficiary from all this growth was services, which now account for more than 70% of employment. This story illustrates that innovation is needed to increase a country's wealth and competitiveness, but the jobs created to employ the citizens of the innovating country are not in the sectors that experience most productivity gains. The jobs are created elsewhere, where productivity gains are much smaller because wealthy citizens are also big spenders and want professionals to look after them when they're sick, to educate their children, and manage their businesses and properties. European countries share this experience. European countries share this experience. Consider three, the UK, Germany, and Sweden. The data that we have here come from the sectoral data set CLEMS, which goes back to 1970, and they report consistent data for the population age 15 and above for the United States and the three European countries. In the figure that you see, I report overall employment rates for 1973, the year of the productivity slowdown, 83 when productivity turned mostly up, and 2003. Sweden is the only country that succeeded in increasing overall employment between 73 and 83, but it did it through a large expansion of its public welfare programs. Industrial employment declined everywhere, and services employment increased. Comparing 73 and 2003, overall employment rates changed a little, except in the United States, where they grew faster due to the growth of female participation rates. The more interesting data for our purposes is shown in the figure that you see here, figure 5. The decline in industrial and agricultural employment was replaced with some overall gains, as shown in the previous figure, by business services and services catering for the individual, including health and education, in approximately equal measure. The implications of this transition for policy in Europe and elsewhere, the implications for employment, I mean, are clear cut. Give incentives to R&D to speed up productivity growth, especially in industry, but at the same time, liberalize services, making it easier to start and run new businesses, liberalize the business environment, reform product markets to absorb the workers released by industry and draw more women into the labor market. Women have a comparative advantage in the performance of service jobs, especially older women whose participation is weak, have a big advantage in healthcare jobs, which is a major growth sector. Sweden has succeeded in drawing into the market women of all ages through the subsidization of jobs where female labor has the advantage, especially in the health and education sectors. And you can see this most clearly here, where employment in health and education is rising in all countries, but not at the levels of Sweden, which subsidizes very heavily these jobs. And, you know, for example, it provides childcare and health services to the market rather than directly through transfers to the home. The United States and Britain have also been more successful in employment growth in these sectors, mainly through the expansion of their higher education sectors. And of the countries that you see here, Italy is the country that has been least successful because of the way that they handle their welfare state. I think given the time, I'm going to stop here. I had some few more things to say, but the important things I wanted to make is about the structural change, the structural transformation, where R&D is absolutely essential, but don't ignore liberalizing the service sector environment, labor markets and product markets, because those are the sectors that are going to attract the people that will be displaced by our R&D activity. Thank you very much.
It's an honor to be here. The paper covers a lot of ground in a very short space, and it contains a number of deep insights that I think are quite important. Now, the paper doesn't present a formal model. It doesn't estimate parameter values. But what it does is convey a broad vision of how innovation, structural change, and employment all fit together. So to summarize a few of the main points of the paper, innovation is crucial for raising living standards over time, but structural change is important for getting benefits of innovation. So innovation raises employment, but it raises it outside of the innovating sector. So putting those two things together leads to a lot of sensible policy recommendations in order to get innovation and ideas, and in order to get the structural change to benefit from them. You know, so things like education and skills, public and private investments, and more flexible labor and product markets. Now, I agree with all of these points. So what I want to do is discuss some specific examples with a particular focus on comparing the US and Europe And that's going to let me provide some context for this broad and sensible vision. So specifically, the things I want to say is first, I'll make three points. So first is that innovation has both a global and a local dimension. So there's a global frontier, and ideas spill across borders, but policies and institutions are going to shape the degree to which individual countries benefit from that. The second is that whether a country implements reforms or not, whether it has the right institutions, there's going to be structural change. And the degree of the institutions within the country largely just determine the degree to which those reforms give you benefits from that structural change. And the third is the future pace of innovation is highly uncertain. What that means is it raises the imperative to have sensible policies. It makes them all the more important. So the first point, innovation has both a global and a local dimension. So in this regard, I actually think about it much the way that Jim Bullard did yesterday in his question. In many ways, a framework of conditional convergence seems to fit pretty well for advanced economies. So what this figure shows is GDP per hour relative to the US level for various economies in Europe and elsewhere. Now, these are conference board data, but the picture looks pretty similar in other cross-country data sets, whether it's looking at the OECD or data produced within the Banque de France. So I just stuck with these. And of course, it's per hour, so it's productivity. There are important issues we've already talked about hours per capita that are not represented in this picture, at least not directly. Now, the US is 100. Advanced economies, that you see in this picture, grew very fast and converged towards US levels over the post-war period. So, for example, Greece and Japan run together until the 1970s, and then Greece levels off at about half of the US level. Japan keeps going until through the 80s, and then it levels off at something like two-thirds of the US level of GDP per hour. You look at France and Germany, they keep going up until the mid-90s when they get quite close to the US level, and then they level off, or as I'll discuss in a few moments, even start to diverge a little bit. So this conditional convergence framework, sort of suggested by this picture, is consistent with the ideas that with the view that ideas don't respect borders. So innovations in one country are, in principle, available to people anywhere. So people in Japan or Germany or Greece can all benefit from iPhones or Android devices. They don't have to produce them themselves. Now, there is, of course, an important local dimension. I don't want to just talk about the global dimension because, as you see, at least a couple of points on this. One is countries look like they level off before they reach the US level. So they fall short of the US level. And a second is that after the mid-1990s, many continental economies stop converging or even being level and start to diverge slowly. So they have lower growth rates after the mid-1990s. So I want to talk about that. Now, this picture took the US as the frontier and just set it to be 100. But what that means is that we can look at what's going on in the pace of innovation at the frontier by essentially looking at what was going on in the US. So that's what I want to turn to now. Doing so is also going to help us to understand why Europe has slipped back a bit on this figure. The main story that people will tell in that, that I will tell, is one that emphasizes ideas and institutions and their interaction to explain that divergence. So to look at the frontier, I'll start by showing US productivity growth and its log level since 1973. So you see the sharp pickup in growth rates in the mid-1990s. I put a vertical line there. But that pickup in growth rates didn't last. Formal statistical tests for breaks in labor productivity growth or in TFP growth, total factor productivity growth, both find breaks in the mid-90s. It finds a speed up, and then it finds a statistically and economically significant slowdown prior to the Great Recession in the early to mid-1990s. So indeed, if you look at the 4 years prior to the Great Recession in this picture, where I put the second vertical line, the growth rate of labor productivity or TFP was almost identical to what we've seen since 2007, going up into early 2015. Now, a vast literature has explored the mid-90s speed up and found that it reflects innovations related to the production and use of information technology. You know, so things like computers and communications equipment, software, the internet, and the like. But it's much more than just buying IT. Getting the benefits really often came from substantial reorganizations to take advantage of how business is done, to change how businesses are organized, or even having new businesses that are better able to take advantage of the ability to of changes in the ability to manage information and communications. Now, only a small literature at this point has looked at the slowdown after the early 2000s. And you could, of course, with aggregate data like this, you can tell many stories. And obviously, there were interesting things going on in the US economy and maybe the global economy in the 2000s. But so what I'll turn to is looking at some industry data that will shed light on this. And that's going to suggest that the slowdown was the flip side of the speed up, that it was an end to the exceptional gains from information technology in the US, exceptional gains when it came to productivity. Go the other way. So what I'm showing here is industry data on total factor productivity growth by different periods of time, periods sort of suggested by the previous period, by the previous figure. And so I'm mostly going to focus on the period prior to 2007, and because obviously, you know, a great recession can cause all sorts of interesting issues with productivity dynamics, as they have in the U.S. and elsewhere. But also focusing before the Great Recession highlights the slowdown in productivity predated the recession. So the bars here sum to average TFP growth for the periods shown. And I've divided the bars into four mutually exclusive pieces. I keep going the wrong way. So the first focuses on some of the unusual things going on in the economy in the mid-2000s. You know, the housing boom and bust, excesses in the financial sector, surging commodity prices, and the like. So the first slice of the data focuses on those kind of bubble sectors of, you know, construction, finance, natural resources. So you see a slowdown in going from 2000 to 2004 to 2004 to 2007. So their contribution becomes more negative. But the other three quarters of the economy was even more important, as you can see from the bars that are actually above the zero axis. And I've divided that into three mutually exclusive categories. So IT producing, intensive IT using, and not intensive IT using. So those latter two are based on estimates of IT capital payments, or the share of IT capital in total value added. And they're measured so that they're the same, the weight in GDP of those latter two, of IT intensive and not IT intensive, is the same. So what you see in the late 90s is this big burst in the contribution of direct IT production, so things like semiconductors. But that kind of, when you got into the 2000s, that the contribution eased. But what you saw instead is IT-intensive industries just got a big explosion in what they were contributing. So this is things like wholesale trade, business services, utilities, a few manufacturing industries, but a lot of them in services. Well, you know, the story for that, to a large degree, is, looks like reorganization. So think of, you know, in distribution. You know, once Walmart was taking advantage of it was changing how it did things, and their competitors were. And then by the early 2000s, you know, mom and pops who were competing with them largely disappeared. So the low productivity firms exited. So there was a massive change in the organization of many of these industries. That showed up as an IT boost or a TFP boost, but it didn't last in terms of growth rates. Once you get to the period, you know, running up to the crisis, and those sort of 2004 to 2007 period, you get back to something that looks more normal and perhaps incremental. So lots of innovation going on, but not at this, you know, transformative rate. So this analysis is the reason why, when I think of, you know, Olivier and Larry's paper from yesterday, you know, I think, yes, in the US case, it looks like there was a change in trend growth around the time of the Great Recession. But in the US case, it clearly looks to me like it predated it when I look at the industry or the aggregate data. Now, even if it's a one-time boost, Europe never got that. They just got the underlying slowdown. So the leading hypothesis in the literature is one that's consistent with Chris's arguments. Product and labor market regulations get in the way. So benefiting from managing information communications requires reorganizations of firms. Often it requires new competitors. And that's those reorganizations. The whole process of creative destruction is more costly if product and labor markets are rigid. So President Draghi yesterday noted some of the resulting differences in IT usage and efficiency between the US and Europe. Now, Chris emphasized that innovation, whether direct production of ideas or through its diffusion, requires structural change. And I agree with that. I keep going the wrong way. So, but that's going to bring me to the second issue, that structural change, or a second point, structural change is going to happen whether we want it or not. So I want to make this point in a way that's similar to what Chris does in his paper, but it actually has a little bit more industry detail. So in the past couple of decades, it turns out the cross-industry pattern of employment growth is almost identical between the US and Europe. So if you look across the horizontal axis, this is showing an aggregate of major euro area economies, shows industry growth rates, or average industry annual industry growth rates by industry from the CLEMS data. The vertical axis shows the same thing for the United States. And what you see is the correlation is above 0.9, and actually the slope of this is close to 1. So the US and Europe got almost the same changes in industry employment growth despite very different institutions. Now, if you can look at this for a shorter time period, you can look at what's going on in the UK and Japan, it looks the same. The correlations are extraordinarily high in terms of what industries were growing and which weren't. Now, it's pretty clear that the industries in the upper right are mainly services. The industries in the lower left are mainly goods. So the pattern could reflect technology, which is, of course, what Chris highlighted, and innovation, where TFP growth has been much higher as you move to the lower left than in the industries in the upper right. But it could also reflect trade or preferences. It doesn't actually matter. The structural change has happened, and it's happened the same way. So an implication of this is Europe had greater labor and product market rigidities and barriers, but that didn't stop the tide of structural change. Instead, what it did is it reduced sort of the necessary reallocations within and across establishments. Europe got an inefficient allocation of capital and labor. It got lower productivity growth, lower income growth, but it still got the structural change. Now, let me bring a note of hope here. European economies and others have been implementing structural change. So this is a convergence plot for one measure of product market rigidities. So the horizontal axis is an index, is the level of the OECD's product market regulation as of 1998. So going to the right means greater regulation. The vertical axis is a change from 1998 to 2013. So as you go down, you see greater reforms, sort of more improvement in regulatory barriers. And so countries that were further from the frontier to farther to the right in 1998 have implemented greater reform. So that is a potential positive. It's hard to know how it's going to play out. Obviously, there's still much more to be done. But Europe has been taking steps. So the final point is that future innovation is highly uncertain. And that's going to emphasize the fact that you need to be ready if you're going to be able to get the benefits from that. So having markets that can adjust is important. So of course, one issue you could point to is issues like the technology of robots and driverless cars and artificial intelligence and the like. So regardless of whether you think how you think these innovations are going to compare to the great pre-1970 innovations that Bob Gordon has highlighted, they're going to lead to changes in the structure of production and the types of jobs that are needed in ways that are often hard to predict. And Europe can't escape that. Now, a second source of uncertainty goes back to the fact that ideas flow across borders. So this is, and this will be my final point. You know, so Chris compared R&D by country. That matters for some issues, but ideas flow across borders. So having more people around the globe looking for new ideas has got to be good for generating ideas. So this shows R&D as a share of GDP for a selection of countries. So 20 years ago, if you were thinking about where is R&D being research being done that's relevant for advanced economies, you'd think the US, Europe, Japan. But what you see is places like China and Korea have been sort of dramatically increasing their investments in R&D, places like India as well. So what this means is there's a larger pool of potential Thomas Edisons and Steve Jobses who are out there raising the chances for future major breakthroughs. And those breakthroughs will spill across borders. So to conclude, this is a really nice paper. My comments have focused on providing some examples and context for the thought-provoking thing. So innovation has a global and a local dimension. In the US, it looks like frontier growth slowed prior to the Great Recession. But of course, one of the issues of that is Europe never got the late 90s speed up in the first place. So there's an untapped opportunity there, which is something that President Draghi discussed yesterday. Now, there's a lot of uncertainty about the future, which means being ready for it is all the more important. But regardless of whether you're ready for it or not, structural change is going to happen. So you need you want the reforms to be ready so that you can gain the benefits of whatever happens rather than just bearing the costs. Thanks.